And it turns out that in certain limiting cases, you see, for example, if you introduce particles, antiparticles, and a Maxwell field, then the Euler Lagrange equations of the causal action will be satisfied if and only if the coupled Einstein-Dirac equations are satisfied. Dirac Maxwell, of course. So if like the electromagnetic field satisfies the Maxwell equations and if the electrons satisfy the Dirac equation. So in other words, you get the dynamics of the usual physical dynamics back. So this is why, this is what we call the continuum limit. So in this continuum limit, one gets back the physical equations on the level of classical interaction. So we have a classical electromagnetic field coupled to a system of electrons. And with gravity, it works similarly. So we also get then the coupled Einstein-Dirac equations. If we introduce a metric and then ask the question for which metrics are the Euler Lagrange equations of the causal action satisfied?
Okay. So if you can get the Einstein field equations from this approach, and also space-time itself is just via this emergent web of correlations, I don't even know if we want to use the word emergent, but you get the idea. I imagine that these are fighting words at a general relativity conference. So what is the technical pushback you receive when you present this to relativists?
Yeah, okay, good question. I mean, with relativists, in fact, they don't object to what I'm doing. I mean, typically, like relativists, they are interested in classical relativists. I mean, I know them quite well because I also worked on classical relativity for quite some time. I mean, the classical relativists, the starting point typically is the Einstein equations. So we write down the Einstein equation, we have some matter distribution, and now we want to find solutions, we want to analyze solutions, analyze the dynamics, and so on. And then this is a problem mainly of solving PDE. So it's like a partial differential equation problem. And many people are mathematicians like me. I mean, they delve into the analysis of these equations, but they often don't really care where the equations come from. I mean, it's just Einstein formulated the Einstein field equations, and I want to analyze those equations.
Right, right.
So therefore, I mean, I have good contacts with many of these people, and I know them quite well. But typically, when I then start talking about causal Fermion systems, then they say, okay, fine. I mean, if you are interested in that, then go ahead. But I mean, I'm more conservative. I just want to stick to the equations I'm familiar with, and I just want to work on the Einstein field equations. So this is my typical reaction I see from this community. And of course, I mean, I understand this well. I mean, for me, one reason why I moved away from this kind of analysis of PDEs is that I really am interested in doing new physics. I want to do something which has the potential of going beyond the standard physical theories. And of course, this is why I pursued this causal Fermion system approach. And then there are other people to address. I mean, for example, I could talk to quantum gravity people. And I mean, they are, of course, more interested in what is the quantum nature of space-time, or with these causal set people, what is the structure of space-time on small scales and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a somewhat different community. These are more like physicists working on gravity. Well, in the meantime, I also have quite good relations with them. I mean, for example, I mean, we have a quite, from my perspective, big conference here in Regensburg, so with about like 80 to 100 people.
Uh-huh.
And also this year in October, and there will be people from different communities, I mean, from quantum gravity, from the dynamical triangulations, from also geometers and the people who do quantum information and so on. I mean, the goal is, of course, to see where the connections are. Do we have similar interests? Are there methods which apply to different approaches and so on? So my goal would really be to bring these different communities closer together, and also in a way where some, as I said, I mean, I have nothing against competition. And also, I mean, there should be different competing theories and we should be able to compare them. So I'm not saying that I want to bring people together and we are all our best friends. I mean, this is also maybe not the goal. The goal is more that people right. talk to each other and that they say, well...
You argue productively.
Better here and the other one is better there. And then in this way, everything evolves in a way where hopefully or eventually, I mean, some progress takes place, right? And often the problem is that there are different communities and but there's often not too much interaction, in particular between mathematicians and physicists, because they speak somewhat different languages. Also mathematicians, they say, I have already interesting problems to work on. Why should I be interested in other problems and so on? And so therefore, I think what one should try is to overcome this so that really people who don't know each other yet, that they sit together, discuss problems and hopefully then come up with interesting new ideas and new concepts. In any case, I mean, this is the motivation for our conference in October. Let's see how it will work.
Mm-hmm. So there are different fields in fundamental physics and they don't interact. They're the free fields.
Well, of course, maybe I'm maybe oversimplifying. I mean, also, I mean, in physics, there are many different communities. So what I'm saying is just, of course, the people I know is already a small subset of people and...
I was just making a joke. Okay, so speaking of fields, by the way, you've collaborated with Xingtong Yao.
So yes.
Yao, for people who have heard that name, but they're not quite sure where, they're in string theory, our Calabi-Yau manifold. And it just has that name because there was a conjecture which was proved by Yao from Calabi. So you've collaborated with Yao directly.
Yes.
Has he ever pulled you aside and talked to you about this, saying this is your ideas are insane or they're genius or they're foolish?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, sure. Of course, I talked with him. I mean, I was his postdoc, I should say. I mean, like I after getting my PhD, I was thinking of I wanted to go abroad, where should I go? And then my master advisor, diplom advisor in Heidelberg, so the mathematics advisor from my studies, I mean, he knew Xingtong Yao because also they... because they worked on related problems. And then he told me to apply there. And then I was very happy and lucky to be a postdoc there. And back then, so this was from 96 to 98, I mean, this causal Feynman system approach was still in a very early stage. And I mentioned this a little bit, but just on the side. And I... back then, I thought what I should do also in order to have a career, to have a chance to stay in science, I should establish myself in mathematics. And of course, being in Xingtong Yao's group was the ideal, environment for doing that. So this means I basically also put this causal Feynman systems aside and I worked on problems which Xingtong Yao gave me. So this was more like PDEs, hyperbolic PDEs. Mm-hmm. And I also started working together with Joel Smoller from the University of Michigan back then. And so this means when I was a postdoc, I talked with Yao a lot, also about string theory. I mean, already back then, I told him that I was critical of string theory. Of course, he disagreed. I mean, he always had the opinion. Of course, he said there's interesting math going on in string theory.
Right.
No doubt about that. And of course, like Xingtong Yao was heavily involved in that. And then he said, well, whether this is physics or not, this is a different question, which I'm not the person to tell, so to speak. But of course, he was also proud that the physicists were using his concept and these Calabi-Yau manifolds and so on. Uh-huh. And I said, so this was when I was a postdoc. And then I kept visiting Yao quite often, regularly at the beginning, and then no longer so often because I didn't travel so much anymore due to family obligations and so on. Mm-hmm. And then I visited him again for a longer period, 10 years ago, nine and 10 years ago. So I was at Harvard for 2 months. And Then I also gave talks in his seminar. I mean, he has a student seminar with all his graduate students and also a few postdocs, quite many people. And I gave a series of talks there. And then, of course, I also asked Yao on his opinion, and he liked it. I mean, he didn't have any direct objections. And, well, but also at the same time, I felt that he was also not fully convinced, let's put it like that. I mean, but also that's maybe nothing I could expect. I mean, I can't expect him to say, well, I worked on string theory for many years, but now I work on causal Fermat systems. I mean, this is nothing I could have expected.
Of course.
So therefore, I mean, I got positive feedback by him and also was encouraged to proceed with that. And also concerning publication of papers, for example, I mean, Yao is also editor of many journals and he was also quite supportive of this approach. Although, as I said, it's not his approach and strictly speaking, it's maybe a bit of competition to string theory and what he is working on, but he doesn't see it like that. And also he's not... he's a very, first of all, very knowledgeable, of course, but also a very open-minded person. So, I mean, so this was very positive.
Oh, great.
But as I said, I mean, he didn't really fully support it. But I think he's still a bit skeptical of the approach, which is fine.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org. Now, your approach also doesn't have supersymmetry, correct?
Yes.
Now, that's also fighting words for quantum gravity conferences.
Yes, I mean, that's the reason is that, supersymmetry is like a symmetry between fermions and bosons. So, I mean, like fermionic matter, this is electrons, quarks. I mean, all the matter is made of fermions, and the bosons describe the interactions between fermions, so like whatever, photons, quarks, and so on. You know, supersymmetry is a symmetry which transforms fermions into bosons and vice versa. And this concept does not fit into the causal Fermat system picture, because this is why it's called causal Fermat system. So to me, the basic constituents of which make up space-time and give the space-time structure are the fermions, or the fermionic wave functions, mm-hmm. whereas the bosons just come up as an effective description of the interactions of all these fermions. So to me, there's really a fundamental difference between a fermion of a boson, and this is why this doesn't fit to supersymmetry. Good. I mean, somehow concerning experiments, it seems that, I mean, I'm not an expert on experiments, but from what I heard, it seems that supersymmetry has pretty much been ruled out. So therefore, somehow I'm on the... So this is, of course, good for causal Fermat systems, so to speak. But, I mean, I don't want to do whatever. As I said, I'm also not so familiar with the experimental... with the status of experiments. It's supposed that at some point, supersymmetric partners of particles were found. Then this would mean that this causal Fermat system approach would have to be modified considerably.
Right. I wouldn't say that supersymmetry has been ruled out by experiments. I would just say that we now have experimental bounds on the masses.
Yeah, okay, sure. So let's put it like that. So far, no supersymmetric partners have been found.
So tell me about the Dirac C.
Yeah, okay. So this is I didn't mention this yet, but somehow in the discussion already, it was kind of in the background, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So namely, if I describe the Minkowski space, or just a vacuum as a causal fermion system, the way this is done is that one considers a family of wave functions, namely those which describe the Dirac C. Now, what is the Dirac C? So, I mean, the Dirac equation formulated by Dirac has solutions of positive and of negative energy. And, of course, this was noticed right away by Dirac, and then people asked the question, what should a wave function of negative energy be? This doesn't make physical sense. And then Dirac came up with a solution, which he called then the Dirac C. And this, his proposal is that in the vacuum, all these negative energy solutions are filled. So this means they are all filled by, I mean, this is all in the one particle description, I should say. I mean, you have this kind of a family of one particle wave function, and all the negative energy states are occupied. And if all these negative energy states are occupied, this means, like in view of this Pauli exclusion principle, if you bring in additional particles, they can no longer occupy these negative energy states. They are already, everything is filled already. So therefore, these additional states have to occupy positive energy states. These are then the electrons. Mm-hmm. So this electron has positive energy. And then what you can also do, you can take one of the states of negative energy and bring it to a state of positive energy. And in this way, then you get an electron, a state of positive energy, and or it is also a hole in this C. And a hole in the C is just, you have to change the sign of everything. It's a bit like an air bubble if you are under the water. So this hole in the C then has positive energy because it's in a hole. It's a hole in a sea of negative energy. So it appears as something which has positive energy and it has the opposite charge.
Uh-huh.
And this is then the positron. So the positron also has positive energy, but it has the opposite charge as the electron. So this is the idea or the picture of Dirac, which on one side was very successful because it predicted antimatter, which was also found shortly after. But on the other hand, it was criticized by physicists and also by mathematicians, because it didn't seem a well-defined concept. If you really take it seriously, this means that if you're just in empty space, there are many, many wave functions or many, many particles flying around, which all have negative energy.
Well, even worse than many, it's uncountably many.
Exactly, infinitely many. So therefore, if you compute, for example, what is the energy density of this Dirac C, it is infinite and negative.
Right.
And the charge density is also infinite. So therefore, you get infinities right away.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.